fit in. This is a real pleasure for me to be able to introduce Greg. Person I have this great admiration for as an architect, as a thinker, as a human being. And it's carved out a very particular territory. I'm a series of essays that many of you might know. I got interested in, and I was told that I was going to describe, and as I've gotten older and I've watched various colleagues develop, I've gotten fascinated in the location of your original ideas and how that changes over time, and how many of them really have formulated in their late 20s, early 30s. And it gave me an opportunity to kind of reread, well, I never read a book until to read more fragments of this piece, and rethink it under those terms, and it's been really, really interesting. And I'm gonna start with something that I just about never do, and usually disliked, but I found some of the things in here that are fascinating. And I'm gonna do kind of a CV of this piece that again just fascinated me. And he came out of Miami in environmental design philosophy. And he goes to Princeton, and he's looking at the theoretical, and he's looking very particularly at Tony Vidler, Alan Calcahoun. But the part I didn't understand at all, he was really interested in composite curves of Michael Gray's. And I actually then, and we were chatting the other day, in the Hanselman House. We're going to talk to the young people. Hanselman House? Ring a bell? And I go, oh, that's really fascinating, because I never thought, when I looked at that, it was completely mind-boggling to me. And it would have never connected that, and it's going to come up in our conversation maybe afterwards. And then he worked for Peter, and everybody knows that, and he was working on the Cincinnati and the DAC project with Peter. And then he worked for Antoine Predick. I'm going to have to ask you about that, and nothing else quite new. He started his office form 24 years ago, and he was 28 years old. And that follows a model of many of our colleagues. The sort of type of independence and necessity that it takes with certain kind of thinking. And of course, he's well known for his work with Bernard Truby in starting the digital environment at Columbia. And he was instrumental in the development of that program. And it makes him, I don't know how you talk about it, first generation in some ways in terms of a complete rethinking of the digital world. But again, the pursuing of that as it's connected to the design practice. And of course, he coined the word blob, which I guess you'll never escape. Or if you didn't coin it, you're given the credit for coining it. And which came very much out of this piece of it that I'm gonna quote out of. And then of course, he's been here for 20 years. And in 01, he was one of the most innovative people in the world by Time Magazine for the 21st century. He won the Golden Lion, et cetera. And then recently, over the last time, he's been collaborating with BMW, Swarovski, Alessi, Vitra, Disney, Imaginary Force. And that's where part of the conversation is going to begin. And then, Greg, from very early on, has been fascinated by in some way, the challenging of style, or the prominence of style as it connects to the image of a particular architect. And I'm gonna again read a piece of this. I am very interested in ideas and in the influences of ideas, but I've never been interested in style as such. I would like to think, and I might be wrong, that you would recognize something because you recognize the ideas behind it, the ideas that drove it rather than its shape and style. And that's going to come up, I'm sure. In fact, on the move again, I would have said, I walked through with you your building for the Korea, the church in Manhattan, and it was an absolute transitional work as you were beginning your work as an architect. And you could see, I could see the fragments of Peter, and I could see elements of what I thought were very kind of LA in its materiality, et cetera, et cetera. And it was, to me, this absolutely typical kind of beginning a young architect, which is leaving very powerful thinking of the office, in this case, of Peter. And there's been, I think, a conversation with you about architecture. And this sort of came up in our conversation the other day, whether why doesn't Greg practice architecture the way people practice architecture? And it occurred to me that it's the other way around, that the way I've gotten to observe you is that architecture doesn't allow you the terms which you need to practice to use your thinking. And it's somewhat limited and resistant. And I think because of that, you represent a another model of an architect expanding that notion of our relationship as, I'm going to say form givers, take that back. And then with that, I would have said, my observation that you're looking at somebody in an extremely vibrant part of his career, that in, as he turned 50, 52 to be precise, it's absolutely on the mark of when architects begin their serious career. And it represents in my, all of our discussions recently, that you're looking at somebody that is at the absolute crux of the beginning of his real kind of serious work, and an incredible vibrancy that's coming out of that particular time. Greg, my pleasure. Your turn.
You're a tough act to follow. I have to start off by going back a little bit and lifting a prohibition that I put on myself around this time that Thom was talking about 24 years ago. And that is like the sweetest introduction, very tough introduction to live up to. So hopefully I can. Around the time of the Fold Bodies and Blobs, I had done this little book called Animate Form. And in it, I was trying to get out of the way, frankly, of a group of journalists who were looking at digital design tools. And because I was using animation tools, I kept getting this question over and over again about what they called the stopping problem, like how you would pick a moment in an animation. But also a lot of people saying that buildings should move. And I thought that was a little bit too much of a fait accompli, so I resisted this idea that things would move. And by coincidence, I used the example of a boat. And I said that the particular form of a hull stores multiple vectors of motion and flow from the space in which it was designed. So a boat, for example, has multiple points of sail, and it's designed to plane downwind and go upwind. But the boat hull doesn't change its shape when it changes direction. And I thought it was very important to say that architecture could engage motion and movement and force and dynamism without literally having to change shape or literally having to change direction or move. And I put this prohibition on myself to look at things that move around. And in the last maybe 5 years, that's all I'm interested in, is things that move and thinking about robotics in a different kind of a way. So for me, and I feel like the whole discipline has gone a little bit this direction, where digital equals design tools, and more recently, digital equals fabrication tools. And people are not noticing what's happening around the world with digital meaning mobility and intelligence and smart environments and interactivity and all these things which a lot of my colleagues were working on in the 90s that I rejected. And instead, where I went is tectonics, layering, fetishizing details where every detail would be unique, decorative patterning, all kinds of these things that are associated with a digital design tool that becomes CNC motivated. So every piece of steel is a unique dimension. Every joint is a different detail. The same detail, just different angle and dimension. All interior surfaces are unique. It was about trying to animate space without literally moving it, and thinking about really closing the gap between design and fabrication. It got, for me, ridiculous with the blob walls and the toy furniture, where unique CNC paths were generated out of these complicated forms so that we could assemble them into these kind of rusticated assemblages. So for me, it really, this was the limit. And as Thom said, I was looking for different languages, like a language of kind of Baroque rustication. But for me, this started to become complexity for complexity's sake, or complication for complication's sake. So, I don't know, the next thing I did, and it didn't really happen like I decided it, but I started to get interested in surfaces which were more, let's say, like that model of a boat hull, where they became taut and minimal, and multiple pathways and orientations would get stored into a single monolithic thing. I also started to get interested in composite materials. So the first thing for me was really this ravioli chair. And I've said this here once before, if not more than once, but I came to Rolf Feldbaum, who's like a guru of architecture, and had three designs for chairs. One was 3D printed, one was CNC cut, and then this one, which was two surfaces. And I said to Rolf, you know, I have this idea where I could make a chair out of 10,000 unique pieces. And he just looked at me and he said, that's not innovation, figuring out how to take a thing made out of 16 pieces and making it out of 10,000. You know, I don't care if it's digital or not, that's retardataire, was the word he used. And so then I quickly pulled this one out. I said, well, this one's made out of two pieces, a hard piece and a soft piece. And he said, that's innovative. You know, taking a thing which is made out of 16 parts and making it out of two, that's what he called innovation. So integrating the legs and the arms and the back and the seat into a soft surface and a hard surface really became a kind of challenge, like how few parts could we make objects in. And it really started with these kind of industrial objects. As well, it started pushing towards plastics, and composites were always the materials that were winning the day for these things. So the ravioli chair was built entirely in fiberglass. It was actually so light that we had to ship it with lead, because a light chair scoots when you sit in it. So we had to add weight to it to make it function. But it started to be the composites were winning the day more and more often. And you know, the kind of scale of this approach of monolithic, you know, kind of integrated surfaces started to jump around. In terms of the language of these composites, the idea is, you know, always they're working very well in cladding, like this kind of intervention and recladding we did at Site Santa Fe in New Mexico. This is a sample of cladding for a Turkish stadium with medics that we did for their bid for one. And it really, for me, came back to this funny ad campaign. And the number of architects that saw this ad campaign, like Renzo Piano saw it, Frank Gehry saw this. You know, Prada decided to use their America's Cup boats to advertise their brand, and they had this image of these sails. And when I saw these sails, I hadn't sailed in probably 25, 30 years, but I saw this material and it looked to me like a kind of hatched drawing or something like that. I mean, it looked architectural to me because it was all lines. And so I immediately started doing research on what they were and who made them, and found this company, North Sails, up in Minden, Nevada, that had this crazy machine, a kind of CAD-controlled machine, that would deform into the flying shape of the sail and lay these strings in the path of the loads so that when you would raise a sail, it would take on a flying shape and give you the kind of optimum aerodynamic shell structure while still remaining flexible. And so I started going up there, became good friends with Bill Pearson, and started to find any way possible to work with them with this new material, but also with this new method of fabrication. And I'm not the only, like I said, I'm not the only architect that's been interested in this North Sails technology. The principle of it, though, is that you put material only where you need it, and you put it in the orientation that the load is in. And I remember with the Korean Presbyterian Church, we worked with Burrow Happold, and they happened to have the only software for analyzing tents, tensile structures, this rolling ball method of analysis. And everything we got back from them looked sad. I mean, it hung. You know, so you would make some decisions and the material would take whatever shape it needed to take, and it was always a kind of saggy shape. So with this, it's a new kind of material in the sense that it's both hard and soft. So this chair prototype you can crumple up and put in a FedEx envelope and ship just as like a letter. And then when you take it out and wave it, it snaps into shape and holds its shape. But it's also a compression structure under its own weight. So when it hangs there, it hangs like a rigid compression shell. But then when you sit in it, it turns into a tension structure and it gets soft again. So it's got this great quality of being hard and soft and also being collapsible and rigid. It's built out of these very, very light kind of gossamer tapes. These are the machines that lay the tapes in bespoke pattern. So you do finite element analysis, figure out what orientation you want the tapes, and this machine lays down layers of tape for you, dry. And then you use that to laminate onto a rigid mold. Okay, and the principle of these things is you're always making two structures. You're making the mold and then you're making the part. So here you actually cook the tapes to activate the glue, put it under vacuum pressure to consolidate it, and you mold these into the shape you want. They take the shape you want, but then when you load them, they become soft and tensile. So this interest in composites for me became a language of integration, of curvature for structure. And I've been trying to take this now up in scale progressively and have a few examples of doing that. I think one of the things I like the best, though, is this whole issue of integrating parts and eliminating mechanical details. So with the Bloom House, this was at the very beginning of learning about composites. But the design is that it's a like a loft, that it's one room. But that one room is subdivided by the folding of surfaces, of the walls and the ceiling. And you can see the composite part is this luminous lantern that hangs down here to kind of bring some scale to this otherwise overscaled space. This was all built by Bill Chrysler, who is around the school a lot. And Bill developed a resin and a laminate that would smoke just enough to get through a smoke test and also have enough intumescent coating in it so it would pass the flame test. So really the obstacle to these materials is getting them through fire codes. This space is very much about how much you can do with really two walls and a ceiling. So there are no enclosed spaces here, but it's a kind of cozy, intimate set of spaces, all defined by these very plastic, monolithic, curving elements. and even down to the cabinets, I didn't want any added pulls or any bevels. So everything is all molded and integrated into the surfaces, and it's all done with the language of surfaces. And the, you know, the cabinets and the cabinets behind the mirrors, the sinks, it's all monolithically done. This was, the bathrooms were actually built in one piece and then sawed up to get them in for the house and then rebonded back together again. Similarly, this, we just finished this little dermatology clinic down in Orange County, where you can see the all of the exam rooms are hidden, so you can open the doors and come in and out of the exam rooms without anybody seeing you from the reception area, with this kind of language of folding curves and monolithic curvature. So anyway, the material has translated for me into a kind of language and an aesthetic of trying to do as much as possible with as taut a language of curves as possible. And for me, it has now started to move towards things that are dynamic and mobile. And lifting this prohibition on things that move, really have to say, came out of this archaeology of the digital initiative at the CCA in Montreal. They decided to start collecting the digital files that were used for projects in the 80s and 90s and asked me to help them identify some of the architects and also the software and hardware that was used by those architects in the 80s and 90s. And I went back and looked at, say, Lars Spreibrook, Bernard Cash, Kaas Oosterhuis, Asymptote, all these architects who at the time were interested in interactivity and immersive digital media. Much more than they were interested in form and fabrication, they were all talking about pretty much self-driving cars. I mean, they were, what they were saying that digital should be used for is exactly what everyone except architects thinks that digital should be used for, about making environments smarter, responsive, and interactive. And for whatever reason, it was this absolute dead end. By like 1995, V2 organization, Ars Electronica, all these hotbeds for immersive, interactive media kind of lost a lot of momentum. And these architects all started to focus on fabrication and using digital tools for construction. So it was interesting to see that moment, and I thought, well, let's think about the kind of the irony that architecture was already there 10 years ahead of Google and any number of big companies that are so focused now on intelligent environments. The other thing is I've always wanted to use computational fluid dynamics and could never afford the time. So I did this thing which, you know, I kept telling myself was a research project, and I really think it is. I designed and built a carbon fiber trimaran. And we worked with a very, you know, kind of big, globally distributed team on this, and spent about 2 years on the design and about a year and a half on the construction. And I called in every favor and debt that I've ever had with everybody in the kind of composite construction industry. It started with, funny enough, an interior, because this kind of a boat's very sensitive to weight. I wanted to figure out how little space could I have and still have this work, you know, potentially to sail a big distance. And took the dimensions of what was our previous boat as a kind of template for what the minimal interior envelope would be, and then started to wrap the whole design around this interior. So you can see there's a kind of California king-size bed, a couple of couches, you could sleep on one side or the other, a little kitchen, a little bathroom, and some storage. And that was the beginning of it, was what was this minimal interior envelope. And you can see this was the first sketch I did before a naval architect was involved. And you want to get this as thin as possible. And this line, this one curve right there, is the curve where all the couches and beds go. So that's how you get the thing to be 2 meters wide. and then it just dives in and becomes, you know, maybe 8 inches wide where you walk. This animation shows, first of all, that curve for the interior, and second of all, which is there, second of all, a curve which is there for what you call reserve buoyancy, which I'm not going to bore you with, but this is a performance-generated curve from the naval architect, and that's one for getting the interior in. This for the main hull. That's looking kind of down the length at those two curves and how they interact with each other. We then ran this through, and this was like going back to the 1980s again, when we would load a silicon graphics machine with the rendering and go away for the weekend and come back and have one frame. We took this platform and worked with Cal State Long Beach and a French FEA analyst and started to look at the computational fluid dynamics of how it would move, and also looked at how much it would weigh and what the structure would be. And this was really interesting because it was what I would call directional styling. Like, we would get information back and I would change that, pump it back into this array of 64 computers and run it for a week, get back results, and keep going through that loop of CFD analysis and design. But not intuitive, I would have. I mean, this was a thing where you'd make a move and wait a week to get feedback on it. It was the first time anybody ever looked at what's called couple hydro and aero CFD. So you can see it's looking at pressure as it moves through the water, and it's also working with pressure through the air. So it's actually sailing itself in the computer. The reason nobody's ever done it before is because this is all based on expert analysis, and it's really a ridiculous thing to try to couple those things up. Every time we would do it, because nobody was driving it, it would always go off into some catastrophic accident. So I have to say this was more like an exercise for the engineers than actually useful feedback. But it did give us a lot of things, like this is where you lose what's called laminar flow. So you get turbulence in all these areas. So, you know, for example, we would go back in and change a lot of these surfaces to make the boat faster. And this idea of high performance design for me was very much in line with a kind of taught curvature language of surfaces to actually make a thing which depended on that for performance was for me a really, you know, kind of great learning experience. In terms of construction, it's a completely different world than building a frame and cladding it. The principle is, and this, we built all the interiors in my office. Eric Weishman and Sean Boyd. It was like a very hot, long summer of building interior furniture that we then brought to the boat builder before they even started building. But the method that you do this in is you cut a mold, seal it up, and then start laminating with an outer and inner skin like little miniature I-beams, so that one skin is always working with the other skin separated by some kind of a core, so that one's in tension and one's in compression. Makes things very stiff and light. So we would laminate, in this case, an outer skin, consolidate it under vacuum pressure, mostly to make it strong, but also to get rid of some of the glue, which is just parasitic. Lay in a core. And there's Hitoshi helping us laminate, supervising, being the chair of lamination. And we would then laminate an outer skin over that core, so you'd get two skins separated by a little bit of structural foam, and then consolidate that all up. And then the most important thing is weigh it. And so a king-size bed, two couches, a little kitchenette, 8 shelves, and a bathroom. All weighed was 55 pounds. And then when we primed it and painted it, it weighed 80 pounds. So what's amazing is, and you'll see there's not a lot of paint on the boat because the paint kind of weighs more than the boat. So we brought this all down to the boat builders before we even ever started, they had all the interior. Yeah, we painted it all these kind of hot rod colors. The, for making the molds, I thought this was, you know, this was crazy big. We just increased the scale. For some of the stuff, we built in a conventional way with stations and strongbacks, and then they would put door skins over this to make the molds. But the reason this is really there is the whole boat you'll see was built out of this pallet and a half of carbon fiber from Medics in Istanbul, and this stack of foam, which is for the core. So the entire material bill of goods for the boat, like these, plus a 55-gallon drum of epoxy, you know, you could put in a pickup truck. So the whole thing, you know, was built out of this tiny amount of material. And so, you know, this is the most, I mean, this is more expensive than diamonds or cocaine or whatever you like to buy. But it doesn't take very much of it. I mean, you could build a house out of it and save a lot of money over balloon frame studs. So, you know, this is how it would get built with the door skins. We just took whatever was more expedient. And this is kind of the cockpit where everybody stands. But you can see the two skins of carbon and then the core of foam in between. For the hulls, we just got very big. So this is a mill at Bill Chrysler's place. The mill can do 80 feet. It's about 50 feet long. And you can see we just kind of hogged out all of this EPS foam, which that's one half of the main hull. And these are for the arms, for the structural arms I'll show you later. This all came down on three trucks down to Westerly Marine. And the same as with the interiors. It was finished with just stucco to fill the voids, sprayed, and then again, that's all the material went into the whole boat. And you start laminating, putting the material only where you need it. So there's two layers of cloth with then, you know, up to hundreds of layers of reinforced tapes, wherever that needs to go. The foam layer, again, bagged and consolidated, and then that's how it pops out. So this beam can, if you support it at its center and at one end, so with 100% cantilever, you can put 13 tons of load on it, and it'll deflect less than a centimeter. And I don't even know what its breaking load is, and two of us can pick that up and carry it around. So it's 9 times stronger than its equivalent steel. So very light, and you can see this piece of that structure, which is the back plate, goes from having 6 layers of carbon at the tip down to 120 layers, which is a stack that's about 2 inches high in the middle. And so unlike an I-beam where you just pick your worst case and extrude it and waste all that material, you know, here the reason it's so light isn't so much the material property, it's the design. So you're putting the material where you need it and you're taking it away where you don't need it. So that idea that you place it where you need it at a fiber or cloth level is what makes these things so lightweight. The other thing is there's no metal. I mean, when you take carbon, which is very conductive, and put a dissimilar metal in it and put it in salt water, you just made a high performance battery. So if you put any metal on this, it'll corrode, and just a month you'll lose like a big stainless steel bolt if you don't isolate it. So even the furniture was all glued and bonded in to make it very stiff. We didn't paint the inside because paint would have weighed a couple hundred pounds. This is it, you know, assembled, but with none of the details. If a lot of the parts, if you were to drill a hole in it, the whole boat would explode. So all of the details for the hardware and things had to be made with special parts that we would even glue on. So anywhere where we had to use a bolt, we had to make a carbon part that we glued and then tap the bolts into. But you can see some of those parts here that hold a winch. So, and then those are bonded in there. But so, like, for example, this piece I know holds 3.5 tons. So you could hang an SUV off of that. And it wouldn't break, and that weighs maybe 8 pounds, something like that. Really incredibly light. The whole thing is about light and strong. but also integrating everything in. So for boat people, this looks like they think it's some spaceship because there's no, all the details were designed digitally and integrated, and there's no like bolting and gluing things on kind of haphazardly. And even down to like connections, it's very old time tall ship like technology. You don't bolt or pin things, you actually lash. So everything's all high performance fibers. But this is a shoelace, and that'll hold, I think its breaking strength is a couple thousand pounds. So this is actually stronger than the carbon. This is all Dyneema and Spectra, and very high-tech lashing materials. Anyway, the last piece that was going to be metal were these quadrants and rudder arms, and I didn't have a solution for not building them in metal. And then we found that Stratasys and Dimension were printing, 3D printing with carbon and glass reinforcement. So these are equivalent strength to aluminum, like if we would have cut them out of billet aluminum. But we sent them to a 3D printer, and they were cheap, you know, relatively speaking. Like the equivalent aluminum parts would have been three times as much money. So those are all 3D printed. They're the most critical part of the whole boat, too, I have to say. That's like the steering. If they break, this is just showing kind of how some of those things get assembled. This is one of those hardware platforms, so we had to use bolts, and so we isolated with those elements. Those are the 3D printed parts for the steering transmission. The look of it, I didn't want, I mean, boat design is very low-hanging fruit. Like, boat designers do cabins and salons and master staterooms, and it's like the 18th century. So we went down, because it was built in Orange County, the pinstriper was a kind of, you know, hot rod pinstriper, so we did these slipped figures on it with orange pinstriping all over. What I love about Southern California is I wanted to get like an airplane windshield, and so you Google airplane windshield and you find Airplane Windshields Incorporated. So we made the molds and vacuum formed this, but they trimmed it all up, and so you know, that's it. Before the mast was on, I've got a video of it sailing. This thing, what's special about it is you can see this is an asymmetric foil, and the boat rides up out of the water is on these. Like it works like an airplane wing moving through the water. And the reason this is in here is on our second race, we went airborne and landed on it, and it was badly, the engineering was the problem with it. It snapped off right at the bottom of the hull and floated away. And 2 days later, I got a note from a friend from Craigslist, and it floated out to Catalina Island. And so what's great about it, it's easily repaired. So we just put a new top on it and started sailing with it. I hope this video will play. This is from the first race we did. A couple of these people, I don't want to besmirch their sailing abilities, but we're kind of a bunch of idiots that don't know what we're doing. But we beat, you know, gold medal Olympians and multi-million dollar boats with a dozen professional sailors. And, you know, in a 2.5 hour race, we won by close to an hour. So just the equipment is the key, not the skill. But it's a very different paradigm of how you would make a boat. I mean, this boat lifts up and flies through the water rather than sailing through the water. This one I like better. This is out with my kids and their friends. But you can see the power boat is struggling to keep up with us, and this is with almost no wind at all. But again, that's the foil that lifts the boat up out of the water. And it, honestly, it was a lot of research by a lot of people that do know what they're doing. Yeah, my son, who I thought would love the boat, hates it. It always goes faster than the wind. It goes 1.7 times the wind upwind, and two times the wind down. So if it's 20 miles an hour, you go 30, and it's like a 50 mile an hour wind on your face. So it's like sticking your head out of a car per hour. But anyway, Thom asked if this did any good for me. One thing it for sure did is it gave me credibility in the world of performance and design. So not necessarily so much with boats, but with a lot of people, I would say companies at the intersection of the digital and the physical, they're very interested in how architecture can inform what they're doing. And I believe that people expect a certain response from the built environment that they're not getting and that they're getting from other technologies. So I'll show a few things, all of which are recent, some which I probably shouldn't even be showing, that deal with mobility most of all. But companies that are involved in knowing who you are, when you're someplace, getting the environment to, you know, do something for you, and again, making this bridge between the virtual and the real. This was a grant we got from the Hay, it's a Hay grant from the Neuroscience and Architecture Institute in San Diego, which Peter Picar was very instrumental in getting to work, where we did a study of moving images on a fixed screen versus moving images on a moving screen. And this is also something Guvench was very instrumental in, and actually did a scientific study of how you would perceive a moving image versus a moving image on a moving thing. And so that kind of work is really where a lot of action is. The first thing that I got involved with that moved was this competition I did with Christian Moeller over in Design Media Arts. And Christian's trained as an architect, but is a sculptor. And the two of us got together. We were invited to do, we were one of three invited competitors for the London Olympic Park, the one that Anish Kapoor won. It was Anish Kapoor, Zaha, and us. And we had this idea to build a golden dome that would follow the crowds around. So you can see it sits on three columns, and on the top of each one of those columns is a KUKA Titan robot. And it sits on a ring that it can spin on, and that way it can follow the crowds around and have some personality. And the idea, the proposal was we build this thing like a carbon fiber boat to get it light enough that we could activate it with these off-the-shelf robot arms. But this was the first thing I'd done that was a moving piece of architecture. 3 or 4 years later, I was asked to do this prototypical living unit by Louis Vermeersch. And he gave us a budget. I think he thought I would do furniture. And he said, I want to look at compact living. So he had said 60 square meter living space. So I had this idea to do something that would roll instead of turn, and where you would live on three different surfaces. So this is a plan with a bed and a closet. That's a plan with the kitchen. And that's a plan with a living space. And it's all on three sides of this surface that rolls around. And so the dining room table would be gimbaled like on a boat. So it could be a lamp on the bottom, and then the dining room stuff all sits on the table on the top. I think you'll see how it kind of works. So that's that. Right there is a dining room table that's now a lantern on the ceiling, while all of your nightstands are right side out. That's the section. So we built a 1/5 scale model of this. This is just a digital rendering. But it's very funny to, just pulling the lecture together, I never saw how obvious all this stuff is, but the, you know, that rotating ring from the London Olympic part then became this rotating ring on a column that cuts through there. So you can see it's belted down to this base. And that's how we would both kind of point it and roll it. This was a small model we did where we just looked at kind of how the furniture was all rolling around inside. And then, this is the big one. We built a touch OSC controller for it, so somebody that was visiting could drive it and interact with it. This is up at SF MoMA. They acquired this, so when they reopen, we'll have the same controller and the two different models that you can drive around. But doing the interface was kind of important for us. And then we built this little, that's the small scale robotics of it. And then the big one, yeah, the big one's there. So that's in Belgium. This then traveled around. It was at Red Bull for a while, thanks to Val. And it was at Facebook. And what's great, if you take this to an architecture school, what you get is everybody's potential problems. Like, the architects will tell you what's going to be wrong with it. You take it to Facebook, everybody wants to know if they could climb in it, could you make a bigger one, could you drive it around? I mean, it's a totally other attitude about design and taking advantage of technology. So, like, because it was up at Facebook, a whole set of connections happened, and I'm just saying this mostly for the students, that my entire life I've had an intuition about something that you could never justify, let's say, to your financial planner. But in every single case, no, I don't mean you, Sylvia, I mean Linda. you're way tougher than our financial planner. So, no, but it makes absolutely no sense. But every single time, like clockwork, within 3 years you find out it actually gets traction. So, you know, this thing I thought was just, you know, ridiculous, but wanted to give it a try. But that whole world up in Northern California suddenly started opening up for exactly this kind of thing. That was it up at Facebook. And all circuitous, nothing totally direct. Just another thing on the whole carbon front, which preceded that, is we were asked to do these index pavilions for the, it's the biggest design award in the world now. It's, in terms of financially, it's bigger than the Pritzker. It's not given to architects so much, but it's about making the world better through design, which means it needs to be sustainable. And it's funded by the Danish royal family, and so they wanted it to be in wood. And as they said, wood was sustainable. And we looked at wood, and actually wood's a really nasty material. By the time you make sure pests don't get it, you make sure it doesn't rot, it's pretty much one of the worst materials you could build with. I mean, the Wood Council is really amazing that they get a sustainable material. But we looked at it and we said, you know, what's the footprint of these pavilions? Because every 2 months they go to a different design festival. So they were shipping around 13 shipping containers of wood pavilions 6 or 7 times a year at enormous cost, but also spending a whole lot of oil. And we managed to do these flat pack pavilions where everything knocked down. And not only could two people build two of them a day, so it was much quicker, but we could fit all 9 pavilions in 1 shipping container. So they wouldn't want me saying numbers, but the budget for the building was 1/5 of the total operating budget for 2 years, which is how long they expected they would last. And so since we could save all that money, we could triple the budget for the building, or for the pavilions, and still be under budget. So we ended up using this more expensive material, but in small amounts. And I don't even know how many people have tried to vandalize it. The first 2 places, one person tried to push it into the sea, and another person rode a motorcycle into it at speed, trying to destroy it. Both ended up in the hospital, and the carbon fiber structure was fine. So they turned out to be, they're still using them now, six years after. But this kind of construction, because you use so little material, is actually affordable, but also much more sustainable than its alternative. Okay, but so, to wrap this up, the few things I'm going to show you are pretty new. The first is a thing we did for Curbside, and the prototype is in Glendale Galleria right now. So you could buy stuff off your phone and go pick it up at this little thing. But it's really at that intersection of online retail and physical retail. And this is a company that's competing with Amazon. They're growing like 50% a quarter, so they're just exploding. But they treat stores as fulfillment centers. So instead of having a bunch of stuff on the outskirts of town and having FedEx bring it in like Amazon does, they overlay software on inventory in cities and connect people with goods that they then pick up in their car. And this is kind of how it works. It's an app, you download it, and you shop similarly to the way you'd shop on Amazon. You can either shop by an item or you can shop by what's close to you. You buy something, and a person physically goes into inventory, pulls that stuff for you out of a shop, makes sure it's what you ordered, transfers it over to curbside, and then runs it back out to the curb and has it in a bag. And they have a pretty sophisticated system of not draining your phone, where they'll call your phone every once in a while and find out where you are. They just call and hang up, so you don't know they're calling you. And once you get within 3 miles, they turn on your Bluetooth and your Wi-Fi, and then they know within a meter where you are as you pull up. So you drive up, and as you're driving up, the person's walking out to your car, and they just chuck the bags in the trunk or in the back. When we had to talk to the building department in Glendale, they said, oh, we're going to need to do a traffic impact study. And I said, oh, no. I started calling friends, asking who the lawyers were for that. We started to build a proposal. It was going to take months. I saw the whole thing kind of evaporating. And in before I could even send them a proposal, Barbara, who runs logistics, had asked their people to videotape how long it took for a transaction. And just by using their employees with their phones, they said transactions under 11 seconds. And so the planner said, oh, we don't need to do a traffic study. So that kind of digital world with data moves at a different pace. We're having a lot of problems dealing with physical stuff. They really don't have the patience for that. They started out by buying and polishing up Airstreams, which was expensive and didn't work so well in terms of everybody wanted to know why an Airstream was in front of Targets and shopping malls. So they then moved to those tents and asked us to design them a identity. In this, I mean, I'm an investor now in the company. So the, you know, sometime in some other context, we'll talk about the business side of this, but the approach was really that we designed their whole brand identity, and I'm their design advisor. You know, what we did was make them visible in the physical world in a way that they weren't at the time, which was not like your standard service agreement for a pavilion. They're at hundreds of retailers already. They'll be at around 10,000 stores soon because they do all of CVS, Target, and every mall developer in North America they're partners with and invest in their company. And so we were trying to look for something which could be a beacon or like a pin, a physical pin, in an environment of seas of cars at shopping malls and in these big box stores in the Midwest, and try to give them an identity which they could also co-brand with their clients, but still keep their own identity. So the other thing is we suggested, because they were telling us that the antenna on the top of this thing, which the antenna needs to be about 20 feet in the air to work, that the antenna would always know where people were approaching from. So we showed them that rolling house and said, why don't we build a rotating pin that could follow you, could follow the signal around. And they're pretty, you know, they're there now with getting this prototype able to follow a phone at distance. So the one in Glendale will be spinning and also changing color so that you pick a color on your screen and it'll change color so you know which one is you if there's more than one. So this is the pickup pod at the Glendale Galleria the day it opened up. And you can see it's got some inventory in it. a little bit of shelter for the customers, and it's really all about that kind of automotive scale and the transition from mobility and movement to architecture. And what precipitated out of this around the same time as this was getting done, we're doing for the Salone in Milan, but with a kind of larger agenda, we're working with John Hoke at Nike to make furniture, the furniture will slowly get larger, that records biometrics off your body and controls your body as a kind of micro environment. So imagine San Antonio Spurs turning the heat up in the finals because they knew they could cook LeBron James and got him to drop out in the fourth quarter at all the games. So this is to avoid that ever happening. It's a structure that'll be able to control the temperature of your body. We've also gotten really interested, not in just that kind of data, but we've been playing around with a drone a bunch in the office. We actually got it for the Biennale. But this is a really quick study we did for a residential tower for Wayne Radkovich, and they asked for a sketch. And so, as I was showing to Melissa on the top of the building up there, we said, how about we just give you a composited model into drone footage of your building? And so, connecting up, let's say, the physical drone with the digital path and the camera, that's something we've been playing around with as a study and presentation tool. But the autonomous intelligent vehicle has become a little bit more than just a presentation tool. This is really, everything else now is very kind of half-cooked. So this is, we applied for the American Pavilion for the Venice Biennale, thinking that we would put the curbside pavilions in Detroit. And then after we applied, I got a call from Cynthia and Monica saying, hey, congratulations, you're in. You have to redesign like the worst building in North America, being the abandoned Packard plant that's been abandoned since like 1956. So we were given this big abandoned automobile factory and asked to use architectural imagination to figure out what to do with it. And so I went to Detroit to a symposium where I was with a bunch of our alumni, like Adam Fury and Ellie Abrams were there. Stan Allen is doing this site as well. And we had a conversation, and everybody was talking about how we needed to get millennials to move in with coffee shops and, you know, cured meats and pickles and art lofts, and it was like, you know, that sounds like hell. That sounds like a Venice I'm eager to get out of. But we did some quick calculations to figure out what that program would look like on this factory. And for me, I said, look, you don't want millennials. You want to get robots on this site. You want to get an Amazon fulfillment center because it's 3.2 million square feet. So I said, what you need is clip a million of it off and make it a fulfillment center for greater Detroit. Because they have some, but they are going to need more. And fill it with Kiva robots and shelves and vans. Second thing is invite in manufacturing again. And do it with, again, thinking about partnerships between civic and private, and try to get building back into Detroit. And what we used as a template for that was Cedric Price. So this is the AD issue dedicated to his Potteries Think Belt, where faced with the same situation outside of Sheffield, he said, use the old train lines. And I don't know, I mean, I know Iman and several PhDs know this well, but make carrels for researchers that could be moved around on rail lines. Make inflatable lecture pavilions that could move on rail line cars. You know, do housing at stations. Have pods that get dropped out into the landscape for people for education and continuing education. he had this idea of industry, and here one of the terminals where these are all housing towers, this is a kind of mixed-use bar. Out here under this gantry, you can move around containers and set up all kinds of different testing and studying and learning, all connected on a rail line and an automotive line. So I kind of thought, let's rethink Cedric Price's approach to this problem and do it on Detroit, thinking about autonomy and manufacturing. So we took the site, so this is the site, these are the precedents, and this is what we could fill. So if we fill the site with an Amazon fulfillment center, we could get 2.5 of them. We can get almost 1.5 Apple headquarters on the site. We can get half of a Tesla factory on the site. But these are in, this is going off of 3.2 million square feet. We could fit 27 Spitalfields markets, 9.5 Tate Modern museums, almost 3 free universities in Berlin. And we started to build the program out of university, museum, market, fulfillment center, factory. These are the existing buildings. It's over 1 kilometer long. We gave the whole place a hair, suggesting giving it a haircut at 2 floors and having a 2-floor depot and fulfillment center where stuff gets inventoried and it gets lifted up and transformed and dropped back down again and distributed. So instead of having this happen at an urban scale, we've compressed the kind of Cedric Price model down to the building scale with 2 university hubs with these moving collaboration buildings that run along rails, new power plant. And then instead of a gantry, a kind of drone superhighway that's 30 feet wide, where you can have little Kiva robots all the way up to robotic forklifts moving goods and transforming things along the length of the complex. Private buildings for companies at about 500,000 square feet each that sit up on top of that gantryway so everything can come from this big depot and fulfillment center, get circulated at a third level, transformed and sent back down. But then this university bar with all these little collaboration centers that could get docked at different places over the years. That's just some of the physical models of it that just left for Venice last Thursday. That's kind of the, you know, you can see this is all the existing stuff. Those are all the existing cores that we clamped all this gantryway to. That's the drone footage of the site. Kind of a heavy video, I hope it plays. I think the computer's tired. All right, the last two things I'll show you. We just started this. It's the same thing, only smaller. This is a renovation and new construction for the Moda Guzzi factory on Lake Como in a little town called Mandela del Lario. Was all built from 1906 to 1912 or so, most of it was built. You can see they have a test track here. And I was with the, well, I won't go into it. Anyway, they were about to make a big mistake. They had gotten permission to demolish a big area in the middle of the factory, and they were building a new factory right in that spot. And I went there and I just said, you're on Lake Como with people on motorcycles and cars and tourism. This would be a great place to invite people into. And instead of having your museum out here at the train station, put your, well, here you can see it better here, you know, reorient this and have all these historic buildings become a hotel, a restaurant, you know, kind of visitor center, and make this a little street of the old factory and have people stay here for like amounts of time, for a few days in some cases even. And then use this entry through here and build a new motiplex, like a new kind of showroom, and have a whole visitor experience out here with everything from cafes and barbecuing hot dogs all the way to getting a peek into the different factory components and being able to make a bespoke kind of Sumizura bike while still having all of the functions of the factory operating. So this is frames and components and logistics. This is the engine plant, and that's the assembly plant, and then this is shipping and receiving. So just a kind of quick study of what we're proposing, transforming all these buildings, building a new building here, new engine plant and logistics center, and then these visitor pavilions that plug into assembly, plug into engines, and plug into all the inventory. This is a very quick kind of site plan that we're getting approval on for demolishing and rebuilding this building, but also all these new uses that line this new kind of piazza out in front. And Lake Como is right here, and the train station is right there. So, but same kind of attitude about the factory, like that people get in the middle of the factory, see it, very different kind of factory in the sense that Motobuzzi are still very handmade. And then finally, I wish I could show you this, but I'm not, I can't. But so I'll show you a little bit. All I can say is, I mean, there's something. You won't, I mean, I hope you don't figure out what we're up to. But so a little, we were asked to start, the same people that own Motobuzzi own Piaggio and Vespa and Aprilia. And they want to refocus from motorcycles and light cars towards what's going on in the United States with autonomy and intelligent vehicles. And so I'm their chief creative officer and have been involved in setting up this company in Boston for Piaggio, both to do new products, but also to pivot this kind of multi-billion dollar company into new markets and new opportunities. So, it's really all about getting this stuff into architecture. So this slide, minus the thing behind this block, is what we've showed everybody. And everybody understands what it's about. Like, if you want to deliver a pizza, Domino's is doing a project with a big car manufacturer, not this car, but to deliver pizzas from a car and cook the pizzas in the back of a car. They're also doing aerial drones that'll deliver pizzas. Now, the car, you can't drive on sidewalks, you can't drive it inside buildings. There's all kinds of things, plus it's a big piece of equipment for delivering a pizza. An aerial drone, good luck. I mean, it takes all kinds of infrastructure to get the pizza from the rotors into your hands. So where we are is right here, kind of scooter scale stuff that'll let you go in buildings, plug into buildings, and access a different scope of the built environment with mobility than you could do with a road. And so, and what I love is how fast we move. You know, so in less than 2 months, we already have prototypes of these things doing their job. But so anyway, we launched this. But anyway, it's already rolling on cobblestone. Mm-hmm. Okay, but so that's where I'm at. Thanks.
Yeah, so interesting. You've been busy. I said in the beginning I was going to start with a mountain, so certain amount of connectivity to that place. And I had taken pieces out of this. Started with a piece of Venice Hallway, and you were discussing his opposition to ideal proportions of architectural order. And the hinges and the indeterminate, the heterogeneous, the undecidable characteristics of writing that or practice of a philosopher like the law. And then it continues in respecting, maintaining incompleteness, undecidability, amorphosis, and geometries which are engender juxtapositions, collisions, dragons, and contradictions. I said, God, that's mine. I thought that was the territory that I was working on. 20 years later, I'm still struggling it out. Well, and now I have to kind of throw this whole thing away. There's a huge shift that's taking place here that I wasn't fully aware of. Between, in my mind, the projects of looking at. I mentioned earlier architecture in its traditional sense, as an architect. My world is filled with contingency. It's overloaded with contingency. Any practicing architect here, it's nothing new. And there's a continual struggle to dislocate architecture with any kind of problem. And I look at your work now, and it already kind of sniffs of it with certain things like your house in Venice. And I remember looking at the section you showed it to me, and I'm going, and then comparing it with chair, the lasagna ravioli chair, the other bed chair, the boat, clearly, which you're there seems to be an alignment of performance and design, and I'm the thinking that's both directly connected to performance and the other that you bring to it, right? That has its own kind of world. And again, you talk about that here in those discussions. By the way, he's interesting in that he's the connective tissue of the old school. And it includes Colin Rowe, and includes a very odd kind of conversation with Bitcower. I don't know, in the next generation, I was that leaves that. But and I look at those, and I look at the dermatologist's office, the house, some of the later projects, and it'd be a whole series of questions I'd be interested in. It seems as though you're, or says,
you ordered some
wine. Oh, my God. Thank you so much. Can you do the honors?
Well, it was very civilized.
But it's not me. I remember having a discussion earlier about the house. I was looking at it. And it seems as though your interests require a fuller participation with the problem. And precise, huge amount of issues in architecture are the limitations that we have in dealing especially with first principle kind of structure. And the boat, of course, seems to be your trimaran, in some way the perfect medium for you at this point of time, because you have more or less total control of all types of levels of performances, tectonic, functional, in all types of ways, and it goes on and on. It's such a complex thing, as well as the shaping of it, and challenging, in this case, the very kind of conventionality that you mentioned and we talked about before, of that industry, in terms of what it brings to that project, right? And a kind of a convention, right? And a kind of lack of any type of, not just innovation in a technological sense, but the broader kind of notion connect to design in the broadest sense of the word that you bring to that. And then again, you see it in the objects, and you see it in your apartment, but now you've taken control again. You need that. Okay, I guess the question, opening would be, and again, there's pieces here that you discuss, you know, to Chumi and to
REM having to do with operational strategy. In your mind, what's the connection as we move through large urban projects? Well, two questions I think that come together, like Detroit. One would be, does the single operating strategy or the breadth of that strategy accommodate teacup urban design? And in terms of locating the language, it seems to be in the two chairs and the boat, so connected to the performances, it seems to be inseparable, and including the tectonic, the material, et cetera, et cetera, versus the language of the final image of Detroit. Mm-hmm. Which now seems, in my thinking, arbitrary.
Really strange.
Clearly detached from those connections.
Well,
you seem to have complete control of these other things. They're absolutely inextricably connected.
Yep.
Right? And it seems to lead you to a. You're comfortable with that because you don't have to deal with all of this other. Attention again, and there's layers of it. And again, the house, I would like to strip away the house and it was one. Same with New Mexico. Take everything away and see what you have left, and then kind of fill it in somehow.
Yeah.
Because that's your interest, you locate your interest, and then things that your strategy is in alignment with, let's say.
I think one thing. When we started with the super studios together, which it was weird to be alone. It's very interesting to be out there with you and Craig at the bench. And I haven't been out there with Neil, but to have more than one going, you see, for me, where the discipline is going. I mean, that's, I think, the best picture of where I think it's going. I'm pretty sure that's where you think it's going. And I remember you saying to the students, look, you're gonna have to invent your own job. You're going to have to invent your own project. You don't want to go work first. You know, you don't want to just go get a job at a firm. You're going to be the generation that has to figure out for yourselves what you're going to be doing. Because architecture is changing that radically. I actually think it is. And I feel very well prepared by the generation of, you know, let's say, Eisenman, Schumi, Poolhouse, Zaha. They were very good at saying, don't give me the brief. Because I'm going to rethink the brief and give it back to you. I'm not going to just start designing. I'm going to actually attack, at some level, the program and rewrite the program before I start designing the building. And for me, I think the briefs are really changing a lot. And I think the most interesting briefs that you can rewrite are in these weird places. I mean, for me, the Piaggio fast-forward thing and curbside, like that, I'll be able to touch millions of people. And it's a totally different world than doing a building. And I really think that our skills are positioning us to do that better than, let's say, electrical engineer, mechanical engineer, industrial designer. They don't have those skills to figure out how to do something for big numbers of people where they're not there to explain it. You know, it's. Because it can't be like an iPhone. It can't be a fetish object, that scale of stuff. It's got to be something slightly different. But so for me, getting to rethink briefs, it's possible now. And it hasn't been for a while.
So it's exploded in the last even year and a half, your opportunities. And so when you look at the RAD Convention, or you look at Piaggio, or you look at Detroit, vis-a-vis this other work for the mobility we're interested in,
yep.
The moving things. What's your, in terms of strategy, in terms of the kind of the alignment of an approach to a particular kind of problem,
where
are you at this point? Because I would look at it and be kind of startled, move from that to Detroit.
Yeah.
It represents, or the tower, even more so. And the question is just, where do you locate architecture? Where your interests lie as you move
for vastly different scales.
Gosh, I don't know.
No, I really don't know.
No, but I don't work that way. I don't know.
No, I really have no strategic plan for how to put that kind of stuff together.
You think there's a set of issues of an alignment between strategy and product?
For sure. No, absolutely. No, absolutely. I mean, look, the thing for Mayne, we spent like not even 2.5 weeks on that. But the first thing we did was market research on unit size and balcony size and figured out how to make a thing which vertically kind of gradated in terms of balconies and units. Because for me, it was figuring out the right brief. And by the way, Mayne and Claire couldn't give that to me. I mean, I think that's why people would go to a firm that would be able to write that for them. It's like with the drones. I asked when we did the Boeing studio, like, when's the FAA going to write the regulations? They said, they're not qualified. Boeing will write the regulations. So I think, you know, we have to write those briefs and do that work or else we don't get to do stuff. And so for me, the tower was totally a market-driven strategic approach to unit size and height and orientation. And it was really just a sketch for volumes, the balconies. There's no architecture to it yet at all. Right now, it's just the blocks.
Is there a continuity, typologically or morphologically?
Probably not right now.
In the quote I read, you're not interested in formal. You're interested in the formal as an index of thinking and process. There is, in fact, continuity that's connected to digital, that's connected to your own sensibility.
Yeah.
And I think some of us would definitely recognize that this is a form, regular piece of work. The next question would be, is there a continuity of that from teapot to tower?
I would never make that part of the problem. I mean, if there is, it's interesting that you would see it, but I would never have a signature like that. I mean, I would hope that kind of stuff would precipitate from something, but I would never start with that.
Then, it's okay, right? I can actually question that. The Detroit project.
Yeah.
Because I believe what you're saying, and I could hold my mind what you're saying. Would it be possible that they would have a look that's specific to that Detroit project?
To Detroit?
Detroit. That would not be characteristic of any form language that's found its way in other projects.
Huh.
And that it would be possibly appropriate because you defined it as a very different, I would say, infrastructure.
Yeah.
Project. And then you, the set price, and that's kind of interesting. The set wouldn't have connected to any kind of
logic, yeah.
Right? It's about kind of a pure idea that precedes concretization, the formalization.
Well, for me, the Detroit project is a little bit of exercise for Bootsy. So the whole, like, the preference on the moving of goods at that upper level,
yeah,
and looking at stuff from above and the inventory below. I mean, for me, it's really more of, like, lifting some weights to get ready for Moto Bootsy. And again, it's much more like a, I would say, routing, planning, looping. It's like designing a capillary system more than the forms. So, I mean, all the forms are little knots and loops and things because they're all plugged into moving stuff around, but it's really just about making a little highway of Roombas that build stuff. I mean, for me, that's what I hope comes through. And we also, like, we had to push this model out. But I'm hoping that what's in the U.S. Pavilion, it's not going to be model-focused. It's going to be much more like HoloLens and data-focused on.
Is it possible that in my reading, this very integrated notion of various performances and a certain type of question that challenges and reinvents those, that ends up within some form of terms, that's going to have an influence on the larger work in terms of the operational strategies that are involved, the kind of questions you have that might lead you, like for instance in the Detroit, but not touching the building,
yeah,
and only dealing with the connectivity,
yep,
the infrastructural, et cetera. And it wouldn't look anything like it, or wouldn't even try to, it would have no mimetic or connection to the other work, because it might even be detrimental.
Yeah, it could be.
Because now it starts challenging the authenticity of the language. It's,
yep,
it's so rooted in the thing that you're really interested in. Because again, the quote seems to be, it's a Formula One, and it's a, it couldn't be a more perfect project for you and your interests, et cetera. And because it operates on such an incredibly nuanced level that, and yet you can tweak it a bit.
There's a lot more.
The first time I saw it, the first thing has two portals on one side and one on the other. Just, okay. It's asymmetrical. But I'm going, okay, it's, here we go. Here's a character. It's kind of, and but you can locate the subjective, the interpretive,
yeah,
within this insanely performative thing.
That's for sure.
And you can tune it. You didn't say that. Your piece broke.
It broke out everything else, that thing.
Yeah, and it's like burlesque. It falls down, and you rebuild it again, you make it again. And that's also kind of really fascinating.
Yeah.
Engineering takes you so far, but finally you put it on the race course. You can use the F1s. You can have these two things that are this big. It changes the, right, the performance of the car enough to win it. That's all you want to do. And you're in the same category. It's only about total performance. Right?
No, it also had to, you know, there's a lot of aesthetic to it.
Of course, no, it's, you've defined the location of that.
Yeah.
It has not, that isn't at the expense. That's,
yeah,
that's the point. You can locate the problem.
No, and even
in the subjective versus the performance.
And the digital tools would, you know, the say there was more design earlier, so it wasn't like somebody, like the naval architect did a package and then I just put a wrapper on it. That it was a cycle of, you know, what if we put the chine here, then you find out it actually helps, and then it puts you in a different direction than you would normally go. And so that whole engagement with digital, not just for shape making, but for performance analysis, I think opens up all kinds of opportunities.
That's funny, the first time I saw it, the panel's reversed. It's usually flat on top, and it does this, and it's reversed, and I'm like, oh, what the hell? It explains to me that one of the, let's see if I get it right. When the boat lifts, the bow goes into water, and if it gets, if it can't release and it flips, down the ocean, it hurts somebody and you've entered your boat, right?
Yeah.
And so it's completely reversed. It's designed for such an incredibly interesting kind of performance. It, the whole thing reverses. It's just fascinating, right? And it really multiplied that times a couple hundred, and after the boat's in.
Yeah. It doesn't go 35 miles an hour.
It's and your comment about architecture environments versus Facebook, I scribbled down, it's so true. Our will, nothing can be done. I mean, put it on the table, all too expensive, can't do it. It's never been done before. I mean, never been done before. Are you kidding me? Fuck you. I mean, it's just an absurd kind of question, right? Also, this kind of very restrictive.
No, they
environment
move,
which doesn't fit you.
No, they move so fast. I mean, the curbside things, we get a call and they say, can we have 25 of them up and down the 405 in 12 weeks? It's just like they have no idea. I mean, we couldn't even get an appointment with 25 building inspectors in 12 weeks. So, yeah. No, it's, and they have no patience for it. And it's very, it's a dilemma.
No, but that's a whole other territory. I've been fascinated to kind of expand the U students, kind of potentially what we call architecture. And it's, it seems to be so archaic and so limited, and it's getting more and more limited, right? And I think you represent one of the models that's fascinating. And you're also becoming more entrepreneurial at the moment, which is not a bad thing. And the type of engagement which architecture is not particularly good at.
Was very risky.
Finding your own course, or they're finding you, maybe, how it works.
Yep. No, you meet one, you meet more. But it's very risky.
No risk, no.
I know.
That's another thing, I mean, architects are not risk takers. You get what you pay for.
Yeah.
And you're in an environment that much more, it's normal to them. And Elon Musk, if you don't believe we're gonna get to Mars, and they're gonna pay you whatever, $100,000, you need to get a job. Right? You believe it, or he's not sure, right? And, and the model for that would be creatures that would definitely understand the risk ratio to the potential achievement.
Yep.
Whatever. And it would be people you'd be interested in.
No, I agree. And it's not just financial. It's big projects. I mean, it's funny how the app world is now doing big projects again. But they don't know how to engage architecture, because that would be a perfect partner for these big projects, like, you know, wind power with spinning planes, and, you know, balloons with internet instead of satellites, and all that stuff. It's very urban planning more, but also architecture, but there's none involved. They're all mechanical engineers and electrical engineers.
And can I assume that your trajectory within your private practice is parallel, or has some parallel to your trajectory as a teacher?
Yeah.
And then it's changing, it's evolving, it's transitioning somewhat parallel to your own interests, your own desires, your own opportunities at this moment.
Yeah. Well, I think the super studio approach I've taken of putting people in touch with industries that rely on innovation, it gives graduate students an access to people they normally wouldn't get to meet until they're my age. And that was also the great thing about Peter's office, is Peter just exploded, so he had very few partners. I mean, McInturf and I were running a big project fresh out of school. So we got access to the president of the university, and, you know, we got access to people that were making decisions, so we could see the value of having an idea with the person living in the world of ideas, you know, rather than the real estate manager or something like that we normally get to meet.
Oh, now I want to go back to something that I had prescripted. You're interested in Michael Graves, and studying with him, for instance. Your work with Peter Eisman, what have you brought forward? In terms of where you are now, you're very articulate, and you've, Peter alone would be an interesting conversation, but in some ways you could be more different. For me, it'd be especially on the alignment of your interests and work. Mm-hmm. If I was a architect, would be a complete misalignment. In his case, with most of them, if capable, there isn't. I think the problem with theory today, the conceptual structure, is its a priori, this would be my comment. It comes in a priori, and architecture is too filled with specificity, contingent, all layers of contingency that require that alignment so early in the process of your operation strategy, and that you need to be have a certain flexibility, malleability, and it comes from also a different environment, which has to be for entrepreneur than the academic environment to survive. What's left with your, if you have really classical background educationally, which makes you born in my generation.
Yeah.
Am I right?
Yeah. No, I feel like the missing link.
Broken.
No, our generation is the missing link generation, whatever the Lucy's are, whatever they are.
And definitely, somehow, Columbia had to be the sum of a marker. No? With you and Bernard, you're very young, and you're absolutely part of everybody. You're all.
Yeah.
All of us were aware of the shift he made instantly within the digital world, or at least the always he expanded or made it very didactic about it. No? And you were right there at that time. And you were also not. You were doing Cincinnati. We were somehow working with your same architect.
Yep.
And he was moaning and groaning and we're making this complex thing without 3D tools.
It was a nightmare.
And it was a nightmare. And you observed an architecture that preceded the technology to produce that architecture. Am I correct?
Yeah, well that...
And understood the need for a much more advanced set of methods, which came with the different, and we made that project outstanding. To make something out of different pieces now is absolutely
easy.
Right. Yeah.
I mean, it's, you know, mainstream. Or it's actually the corporate practices. Two things I've seen happen, which I didn't expect. One was, I always thought there'd be a community of architects that would look out for each other. Like, I always thought there'd be a Philip Johnson making sure that the level was a certain way. And I mean, it was not fair because Philip was picking his favorites, but also if you went below the bar, you were out. And Philip connected people with people in industry in a way that nobody else is doing right now. And I mean, that's why Peter could still get away with wearing a bow tie and stuff. I mean, he never had, like, you couldn't roll Peter into a meeting in Silicon Valley. It would be like you'd walk in with a brontosaurus or something. But he never had to get out of that 1950s and 60s thing because there were people looking out for that generation. And I can't believe how quickly that's evaporated. At least in my opinion, there's not that.
And you were quickly writing using words like groovy and cool.
Yeah. Well, he used to try to get me to put a bow tie on for meetings. Literally, he would say, you should start wearing a bow tie. And I was just like, there's no way you're going to get me in a bow tie.
My world felt that resistance.
But he was a really radical guy back then.
Is that any part of that? Or were you ended up? Or was it just the technology that took you someplace?
No, I love to draw curves. Before there was that, the only reason I used a computer is I wanted to draw curves. No, I went to Princeton to learn to draw them with a compass, you know, like Michael Graves did. So, but no, the other thing that I never thought would happen was how quickly all this stuff got taken up. And now I'm just frantic to be part of the game. Because then I remember everybody saying, nobody's ever going to use these computer things, you know. Todd and Billy were like, we're going to draw with pencils on burlap or whatever they were saying. No, they're using computers. Well, all this is digital. No, but I thought, they're right. This is not, you know, I got 50 years to work this computer thing out. That's what I thought. And then all of a sudden you see like Peter Pran and, you know, pretty soon it's actually a little bit been polluted. So you don't want to have a digital looking thing because it's so, makes you look like a corporate practice.
Well, better said than the autism.
Yeah. So anyway, I never thought it would move so fast. And I got to tell you, I was at Google X last week, and they got 100 little cute things driving out the door every 3 minutes. One shoots out, drives around, comes back. They're doing 3 million miles a day virtually driving these cars. They want to put sensors all over our motorcycles in Italy. I mean, they are moving so fast, you have no idea. And if you could put that stuff into a building, it would be amazing. But it's going to happen really quick.
I'm going to ask one more question to turn around to the audience. Is that been all? What would your advice be to the students here in terms of the ubiquity of ramping up in terms of your formal sense? Because I would be with you. Exactly what you're talking about. That seems to have been a unifying element of schools now. That you can no longer differentiate a SIR, a UCLA, a Yale, name the school. That you can go to the jury and see more or less somewhat common set of its constraints and develop the work or predilections for language.
Well,
it's so wrapped up in the formal as some sort of isolated to them.
I mean, I'm,
I'm a big proponent for new form and new organization and new language, but I guess what I was just saying to the studio today is we were kind of sorting out strategic stuff. I said, you know, everybody's got a solution, but you can't tell me what the problem is. Everybody's describing shapes and how you move around, but nobody's telling me what the problem is that they're inventing. And so I don't think people come to you with problems. Like, that's also different today. I think you have to invent the problem, otherwise it just turns into, you know, house style. And I think there is a lot of that around. But I think, you know, especially for students, you got to come up with what you think is the problem that's going to carry you pretty much your whole career. I mean, everybody I know that is happy, let's, you know, and probably that involves being successful, they knew what they were onto when they were in their 20s.
What would be the single thing that propelled you that you're still working with as a problem?
Solving problems with curves. I mean, literally, as a high school kid, that's what I was doing. You know, I was in shop class with a compass drawing, you know, geared cones and stuff.
On board one. How about the, you know, within the educational level? Who left you with some enduring problem?
I don't know. I think all the best teachers I had were trying to figure out how to talk to people through design. And even the reason I love, like, Rolf Feldbaum and Alberto Alessi, I mean, that's all they're about, is how do you talk to somebody with a chair, how do you talk to them with a coffee pot. You know, not that it has, like, a story or, you know, something banal like that, but actually how do you have a conversation without standing in front of your object explaining yourself. And I think that's what, hopefully, the students get. Because if you don't get that as a student, you certainly don't get it as a professional. Like, we're notoriously bad about standing in front of our stuff rather than standing behind it and letting it do the work.
Questions?
There are two things you said that really struck me. The first was the Olympian comment. It's not the equipment. Sorry, it's not the people. It's the equipment. And the second thing that you didn't use the word, but I was looking at some the Detroit project and thinking guts. Let's say guts of kidney, just like actually, but not on a cellular level, but more so on a programmatic level. And so let's say the infrastructure that would have facilitated the humans. Now the application of the equipment that are available to you are used for urban design, sometimes on the inside of architecture, and in the case of the Como project on the outside of architecture, urbanism. So I guess I'm thinking, you know, in terms of a new metabolism of sorts, having a kind of hardware-software relationship between what architecture does and what the human receives.
Yeah.
It's something that, you know, would, I guess, one of the takeaways that I have so far just listening to the lecture.
All I can say is what I keep trying to get our students now to do, which we have not succeeded in yet, is using all the crowd software to help us design. Because I think that is the coolest stuff I remember when I first got a silicon graphics machine and we were modeling everything with particles. It used to be so slow. And now you look at whatever it is, the Hobbit movies, or I don't know what it was done for, but where you see crowds of hundreds of thousands of people running through environments and just figuring out. They just move in a way that people move, but that we would never design for it. You know, it's absolutely not like the axial relationship from point A to point B when you shoot a fire hose of people through a building and see how they behave. It's the most interesting design technique that I've seen lately, and I don't know why we can't use it intuitively. But that whole thing about, I really hope we get there with Detroit. I mean, actually, we're going to work with Framestore on it because they know how to do it. But I'm hoping that thing comes to life
with the chaos of things moving in it, and it really does end up looking like, you know, a CAT scan or a circulatory system, metabolism or something, rather than just axial things moving on tracks. But anyway, it's taken 20 years for that stuff to be a designer's fingertips. As far as I can tell, it's at people's fingertips. But I haven't seen anybody use it very usefully so far.
No, no, it's not very interesting at all, but it is curious.
It's a guy that knows something about the cars.
The move towards autonomy is what I'm really struck by. As we're talking about Google, et cetera, et cetera. And also the kind of move towards kind of autonomous architecture in which people are bystanders. And rather than being culturally engaged, and I don't think this only applies to your work, I think it's, you know, the corporate work, et cetera. Eric Moss always says architecture needs an enemy. Architecture needs the polarity of a culture pushing and pulling and has, you know, internal strife and is moving towards something. And in a way, there's a vacuum in that aspect of the built environment. You know, the culture that you're working in, that we're all working in, is not providing any grounding. And so I kind of see this move toward autonomy as one that is a kind of safe place that does give the room for, you know, onanistic, let's even say, activity, because there's no tension between the other side. And I can totally subscribe to it and understand it, but I don't think we ought to take too much joy in it.
Well, I mean, I think there's a certain part of the world that looks at architecture as a frame, and that life happens inside the frame. And it's probably always been that way, but for sure that's how Silicon Valley thinks of it. Yeah. Like, they really think of it as a dead, empty container that gets animated with everything else. And I think it's our job to animate the container and confront people, so whatever. So your lecture hall, you come in the morning, it looks different because it's rearranged itself. It's frankly, it's so easy to do, it's amazing. I mean, when we pay attention to how we use the space out at Ideas, that stuff is moving around all the time, it's just doing it with absolutely no intelligence. And it would be easy to give it intelligence. I mean, I think that's our job, is to figure out how to engage, because otherwise we're gonna be just the box, the empty box people that everybody else fills with interesting stuff. But that's for sure how that world thinks of architecture. You know, it could be a different style box, but they really think of it as a inert thing that should get animated. Although, you know, some of them are aggressively looking at it, but they tend to be doing it through the lens of construction. Like, how does Google get into building business and stuff? So, but yeah, I mean, I think autonomy, that's kind of it's a bad word. Like, if the whole world didn't use the word autonomy, I would try to use a different word, like intelligence. But I think the built environment needs to get a lot smarter, just as people expect it to be, too. And we don't teach it, we're not that engaged in it. I mean, it's funny how it all started here, MIT, at a couple places, and it became more about form and construction and less about building intelligence. And I think there's a lot of action in that now. I mean, I grew up in a little town called Vermilion, Ohio. And when I was 16 or 17, I saw there was a book by J.G. Ballard that had a story in it called Vermilion Sands. And so I just read it because I lived in Vermilion. And I read this thing about these houses with personalities in the desert that kind of went schizo. But it was all about how the houses would change based on the mood of the occupants, and then they started changing based on the mood of the house. But I thought, that's such science fiction.
But you realize with Nest and everything, it's absolutely mainstream reality coming at us like at 100 miles an hour. So I never thought science fiction would end up being real. But it is, but not in architecture. I mean, there's kind of Jetsons looking architecture, but there's not, it's not delivering the full package. Like, I don't get my lunch out of a machine and all that stuff. But I know there are a lot of people working on that. So.
You were describing the kind of people that you're working with now, that they have built into the way they work, the way they communicate, the way they live, the way they tour. There's a kind of impatience that, you know, they need the thing now in a very specific way. And the implication was that architecture needed to figure out how to keep up. I wasn't quite sure. I was just wondering whether there was any value in slowing that down.
Sure.
I mean, do you want to feed it at speed all the time, or how would architecture negotiate those different forms of duration?
No, it has. That's, you know, reclaimed barnwood floors and smoked meats and pickles. I mean, with those same people that are into that speed, they're into like living like 19th century, you know, pioneers. And unfortunately, their architectural taste is more the maker culture, you know, distressed wood.
I guess I wasn't really asking about something. No, I was asking about something else. So you would think.
No, I'm saying that's literally a one-to-one correspondence of that world in architecture. So I don't know how you break it, but you got to engage it in a different way than luxury materials with, you know, fake value added because they look worn and distressed and natural. But I mean, look at like Johnny Ive's house. You know, it's unthinkable. You know, the iPhone person, you should see this house he lives in that he designed himself. He's really more proud of it than the iPhone. But it's like ridiculous. But nobody's there telling them how ridiculous it is. No, I mean, I take it back. There's some really good examples. I think Facebook is great. Facebook's headquarters is great. But it's Jonathan Ives, probably.
First, very inspiring lecture. Thank you for basically taking architecture and expanding that. I was first struck by the incredible, seemingly oppositional duality of an amazingly uncompromising project like the boat versus basically like Curbside versus possibly what I think Piaggio might be, which is about enhancing a given contaminated context and trying to basically enhance it through some sort of another layer of efficiency, or it's kind of like a system prosthetic, right? You're making something better. So it seemingly seems oppositional, but then I'm just curious that maybe, do you engage inside the boardroom of the meeting of Curbside and Piaggio with the same incredible reiterative, like data-driven, strategy of information, customer relationships, performance of the lifestyle, as you did the boat?
No, just because there was no budget or timeline on that, on the boat. No, because we spent 2 years designing it. But whereas, I think the Curbside, it's a problem like designing a photomat. Like, we weren't designing one, we were designing the family of them that would carpet America. So, in everything was based on a prototype that gets duplicated, and it really is very brand-driven. But they had no brand. I mean, they had that app, that was it. Like, even the logo, you know, we designed.
It seems like from the way that you approach a project, the embedded reiterative process will allow you, maybe perhaps the first contract was just to do the brand, but in terms of making the brand
better. It was really to do the hut. I can't even tell you like what the budget was to do the hut. I mean, it was a joke. So we did I don't know, maybe five or six takes on the hut, and then we narrowed it to three, and then we took those three and did like another dozen, and then slowly just started killing them off till we got to the one that was not so, I mean, these have to be in like North Dakota, and Louisiana, and I mean, they have to be able to hold up like in big box retail situations in the middle of America, and people have to go shop at them. So, but we didn't actually show it to anybody. It was just four or five of us making that call. But it was really very language driven. I mean, there were some, there were none though that were that out there. But yeah, it's like designing a product. I mean, it's. Like, I would love, look, you and I would go for a drink in October 2016. Because no, it's all, it's all together. The whole thing is all together now. So it's the inside the environment, outside, vehicles, the whole schmageddy.
Well, I think we have to end the discussion tonight. Thank you, Greg. Thank you, Thom.